Today, journey to the tiny nation of Bhutan, where some people are trekking for hours through the Himalayan mountains. We'll tell you where they're going and why. That's next on Canadian Edition. Well, hello and welcome to the Canadian edition of the 700 Club. I'm David Gerritsen. So glad you could join us for today's program. You know, one of the most important things we do at the Canadian 700 Club is to pray for people in need. And we have people on the other end of our phone lines who know what it means to have prayers answered. And I want to share an answer to prayer with you that's very exciting. Glenda, who's one of our prayer team members, had a 70% blockage in one of her arteries and a 40% blockage in the other arteries. She had been believing for a miracle with no blockage at all. She went to the doctor for more tests, and he said, listen to this, that it could never unclog, only get more clogged. So in faith, despite what the doctor said, Glenda, our prayer warrior, went through with the tests. Knowing that her God was able, she continued to confess a healing. When the test results came back, the doctor couldn't believe the results. The 40% blockage was totally cleared, and the 70% blockage was now only 40% blocked. The doctor is amazed, and Glenda is believing for a complete 100% healing. Now, we have that on file in our files at the Canadian 700 Club as actually happening. So if you have a need today, we want you to know that one of our highest priorities is to pray in faith, believing that God, through the Holy Spirit, is going to make a difference. And people like Glenda are standing by to take your phone calls. They know what it means to have prayers answered. 877-431-7887. Or 416-431-0700. Call us right now. We'd love to pray with you. Well, it's normal for Canadians to practice their religious beliefs at home and even at work. But in the tiny nation of Bhutan, Christians can be denied a promotion because of their faith, or they can be put in jail for sharing the gospel in public. Gary Lane brings us a rare glimpse inside this Buddhist kingdom.
Welcome to Bhutan. A Buddhist kingdom of less than a million people nestled in the midst of the Himalayas. It's an isolated country. For years, large numbers of foreigners and outside influences have been kept out. But some aspects of Western culture are now slowly creeping in. Fewer people on the streets are wearing traditional Bhutanese clothing. And it seems just about everyone has a cell phone. It's a season of change here. A new young king officially ascended to the throne in November 2008. He's following initial steps taken by his father to transition the nation to democracy. Also in 2008, the nation's first parliamentary elections were held, and a new constitution was adopted. While it guarantees freedom of religion and practice, the attitude of the government and people here is, if you are Bhutanese, you are Buddhist. But there's a small underground Christian community in Bhutan. This church, high up in the Himalayas, is attended mostly by immigrant Nepalese. Some of its members walk for several hours just to attend Sunday morning service here. But a growing number of Bhutanese are starting to follow Christ.
Because they're scattered throughout the country, meeting in house churches, no one knows for certain how many ethnically Bhutanese Christians there are here in this Buddhist nation. Now, some of them talked to us, but few wanted to share their stories on camera.
One church leader agreed to share with us only if we protected his identity. We'll refer to him as Pastor George. He says the Bhutanese church started growing in the early 1970s.
The growth has been quite small, but nonetheless it's still growing. It's almost pioneering in some sort of ways, like the churches were probably at the day of Pentecost. There's no proper theologically trained pastors or those in leadership as well. It's all led by lay people. It's all in homes, in home settings. Groups are very small, loosely knit.
They meet in homes because construction of non-Buddhist religious buildings is restricted by the government. The import of Christian materials is not allowed, and Christian missionaries are prohibited from entering the country. The government denies Christians the right to share their faith in public.
I think you can be fined, and at the worst, you can go to jail as well.
The nation's newspapers are now recognizing that a Christian community exists in Bhutan. Often Christians are depicted negatively. This government newspaper, the Kunsel, talks about Bhutanese joining Christianity for economic reasons, so they don't have to spend money for various rituals. It told of a 76-year-old who was beaten for refusing to convert to Christianity. It also reported that Christian groups in one village were causing unease. Recently, the Bhutan Times denounced what it called vague evangelist websites that claim persecution of Christians in Bhutan. It said the government is not in the persecution business. Tell that to this Christian. He wouldn't appear on video, so we made an audio recording of his testimony. He said back in the year 2000, an angry government official threatened to kill him if he did not renounce Christianity and return to Buddhism.
He said, otherwise, who knows? He's barely out of the country. And he said, for the sake of country, I will kill you also. I think government will not object about this. Because to kill you is to save the people from going to Christian.
But he stood firm in his faith.
I said that I will not give up. I will not give up because he is the only God I find as a true God. Then I knew that. No, Jesus saves me.
Nearly a decade later, government officials are making fewer threats against Christians.
I think there's a notion that it should get better with the introduction of new constitution. But that says very little in terms of, in actual practice, you can be falsely sometimes charged by those opposed to Christianity. You can be made to suffer for it.
Still, they press on, mostly in private. These pastors recently attended a training seminar. Christian leaders here say more sound biblical teaching and leadership training is needed. They also ask that Christians around the world pray for them.
Pray the church will be prepared to meet all the challenges. In as much as we have the assurance of love and prayers from the West, but it's ultimately the Christians here that will have to stand on their own under the Lord's banner.
And he promises he will never leave them nor forsake them. Gary Lane, CBN News, Thimphu, Bhutan.
You know, I think it's good for us as Canadians to realize that it does sometimes require a commitment to share your faith. And it helps us to take a look at a place like Bhutan. And I know we often will feel persecuted in the workplace about our Christian faith or perhaps in our neighborhood or around friends, but we're not being persecuted like folk are overseas. But today, maybe you are paying a price for being a Christian. A lot of times we have to struggle with a view which is very popular in Western Christianity, that if you just trust Jesus and believe in Jesus, everybody's going to love you, everything's going to be fine, everything's going to work out well. Sometimes that's called a prosperity view of following Jesus Christ. But Jesus said, don't be surprised. If they persecuted me, they'll also persecute you. And so on occasion, we may well face persecution for our Christian faith, and the key is how we respond to that persecution. And people will know that we're really Christians if we respond to persecution like Jesus responded. And how did Jesus respond? Well, sometimes he didn't respond at all. It said that he was like a lamb that was not speaking, not bleating before its shearers, not saying anything. Sometimes we just need to ignore the complaints. Other times we need to, in love, respond and to say to people, I am following Jesus because he has changed my life. How you respond, the way you respond, the attitude that you respond in will make a difference in terms of how God may use that persecution as he did with Jesus to make a difference in people's lives. And so we just want you to know if you are paying a price today in your family, in your community, in your workplace, we would love to pray with you and encourage you so that you might stand strong in your faith. Don't be surprised when persecution comes, but know that God himself, through Jesus Christ, is standing with you. So call us at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700, and we'll pray with you to stand firm in your faith. Well, up next, in some cultures, the man you're about to meet wouldn't have made it past birth.
The whole church was mourning, you know, like, why would God let the pastor's son be born that way? And my mom, at first, she didn't want to hold me. She didn't want to, you know, breastfeed me. And it took them quite a while before they could trust in God that he didn't make a mistake.
Find out why this man says his birth was no accident. Stay with us. Nick Vujicic was his parents' firstborn son, but no one sent flowers, and no one thought Nick's birth was anything but a mistake.
What makes someone extraordinary? Their abilities? Their talent? Or simply, their smile? When I first met Nick Vujicic, I knew I had just encountered someone extraordinary. From the moment he began to share his amazing story with me, I witnessed firsthand how God is using a man with no arms and no legs to be God's hands and his feet.
My dad was saying that he was, you know, his head was next to my mom's head as I was being born, and he saw my shoulder, and he just went pale. And was hoping my mom didn't see me because he saw that I had no right arm. And my dad had to leave the room, and he couldn't believe what he saw. And the doctor came in, and my dad said, "My son, he has no right arm." And he says, "No, your son has no arms or legs." And he said he nearly fell on the floor. He couldn't believe it. And the whole church was mourning, you know, like, why would God let the pastor's son be born that way? And my mom, at first, she didn't want to hold me. She didn't want to, you know, breastfeed me and all that. She just felt very uncomfortable for the first 4 months. And it took them quite a while before they could trust in God that he didn't make a mistake, that he didn't forget them or me.
Nick's parents gave their fear and even disappointment in their son's disability over to the Lord. They chose to trust God and his promise that he had a plan and purpose, a hope and a future for their son. But as the years passed, Nick, on the other hand, had many challenges trusting in a God that he felt gave him less.
I challenged God. I said, "God, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I won't probably have peace until you're in my heart. But I will not let you in my heart until you answer me, why? Why did you take my arms and legs? Why didn't you give me what everybody else has?" And I said, "God, until you answer me that question, I will not serve you." And so I wanted to end it. If God wasn't going to end my pain, I was going to end it myself. So at age 8, I tried to drown myself in a bathtub of 4 inches of water. I told my mom and dad, "I'm just going to relax in the bathtub. Can you put me in the bathtub?" And I turned over a couple times to see if I could do it. I couldn't do it. The thought that stopped me from going through with it was the love for my parents. Because I love them so much, and all they did was love me. And I thought to myself, if I actually went through with this, I pictured my funeral, I pictured my parents, and all I saw was guilt on their shoulders that they couldn't have done more.
That would be the last time Nick would attempt suicide, but it wouldn't be the last time he would come face to face with those deep issues that made him want to end the pain. Then one day, Nick's mother had him read an article about a severely disabled man, and that man's story made a huge impact on Nick.
I have a choice to either be angry at God for what I don't have or be thankful for what I do have. And my mom, she said, "Nick, God's going to use you. I don't know how, I don't know when, but God's going to use you." And those seeds started penetrating in my heart. And that's when I started seeing that there is no point in being complete on the outside when you're broken on the inside. And I found out that God can heal you without changing a circumstance. I gave my life to Jesus Christ when I read John 9 at age 15, where a man was coming through a village, and a man, This blind man from birth, Jesus saw him. People said, "Why was this man born that way?" Jesus said, "It was done so that the works of God may be revealed through him." And in 2 Timothy 3, verse 16, it says, "All scripture is God-breathed." And I believe God breathed in me life and faith. This faith came over me. This peace came over me. And I felt like God answered my question.
And what was the question and what was the answer?
The question was, why? Why did you make me this way? And the answer was, do you trust me? That's the question. And when you say yes to that question, nothing else matters.
But what was it specifically for you that made you say, "Lord, I'm going to trust your word because I know it's true. I'm going to trust you even if I don't know what you have in store for me tomorrow."
Right. Because there was nothing else I could find. there was nothing else that could give me peace. I knew arms and legs wouldn't give me peace anyway, arms and legs alone. I needed to know the truth of who I am, why I'm here, and where I'm going when I'm not here. And I haven't found that truth anywhere else but in Jesus Christ.
And it was in Jesus Christ where Nick found the strength to do what many thought would be the impossible.
It's so hard to be strong when people constantly say, you're not good enough, you know, go away, you know, we don't want anything to do with you. Nick, you're a nobody. Nick, you can't do this. Nick, you can't do that. Nick. In life, if you don't know the truth, then you can't be free, because then you'll believe that the lies are the truth. But once we realize that when we read the Word of God and you know the truth of who you are, I am not a man without arms and legs. I am a child of God. I am forgiven of my sins. I'm an ambassador of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I'm nothing but a servant of the Most High God. This is not about Nick. It's not about Nick's capacity and capability to become this conqueror. I am nothing. I'm nothing. God, though, lives in me, and I now live in His strength. And whatever Jesus conquered, I conquer. I believe if God doesn't give you a miracle, you are a miracle of God for somebody else's salvation. And I thank God that He didn't answer my prayer when I was begging Him for arms and legs at age 8. Because guess what? Because I have no arms and no legs, He's using me all around the world. And we've seen so far, approximately, this is conservative, 200,000 souls come to Jesus Christ for the very first time in the last 6-7 years. And what would you rather? Would you rather have arms and legs, Nick, here on earth and no arms? No. Whatever His will is, because I'd rather have no arms, no legs temporarily here on earth to be able to reach someone else for Jesus Christ and then spend eternity with them there.
In the last decade, Nick has shared his story in 24 countries to over 3 million people. And whether he's talking to a stadium packed with people or one single person, his heart behind the message is the same.
God loves you. That He hasn't forgotten your pain, He hasn't forgotten your family. And maybe while you're watching this interview, you've compared your suffering to my suffering. And that's not where hope is, to know that someone else, in your opinion, is suffering more than you. That's not where hope is. But hope is in the name of God, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hope is when you compare your suffering to the infinite, immeasurable love and grace of God. Isaiah 40, verse 31. Says those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength, they shall mount up on wings as eagles. I didn't need my circumstance to change. I don't need arms and legs. I need the wings of the Holy Spirit. And I'm flying because I know Jesus is holding me up. Don't give up on God, because God will not give up on you.
Yeah, what a powerful story, and one that I'm trusting will minister to you. As I was praying about this particular piece for this show this day, I felt like the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, David, you're going to be ministering to at least one person who has been told early on in their life that they're worthless. Matter of fact, the phrase that kind of popped into my spirit was a phrase like, I wish you'd never been born. You've been nothing but a problem to me. If that's you today, I want to tell you, I want to speak to you very personally and very intimately. That is not from God. That probably was spoken to you by a parent, perhaps a mother or a father. And I know how devastating that has been to you. I know that's destroyed your life. It's haunted you all of your life. I'm not sure how old you are today, but I'm convinced that that particular phrase has been something that's been playing over and over and over again in your mind. And somehow you have been convinced, and it's Satan, the enemy of your soul and the enemy of God, who's convinced you that that statement is right, that life really is something that you should not have, that the world would have been better off if you'd never been born. That is not true. I want to go take you back to an Old Testament character. His name was Jeremiah. And Jeremiah came into some difficult situations, a very difficult time in Israel's history. And he was a young man, and God spoke and said to Jeremiah in chapter 1, verse 5, I know that I have a plan for your life. I knew you before you were born. I know that you can make a difference in Israel this day. And I feel like the Lord would have me say to you this day, whoever you are, that God wants you to understand that you're not a mistake. You're not here by some cosmic collision that should never have happened. You're here because God Himself looked down through all of history and believed that your life and the impact your life could have was important for this day and this time. And so I want to rebuke Satan in Jesus' name. And Satan, I rebuke you right now in the power of the risen Christ. And I declare that all the lies you have spoken shall be revealed in this person's heart at this particular moment as nothing but lies. And I confess, Lord Jesus, through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will begin a healing process in this person, that they might know that they're not a mistake, that you will help them overcome all of the trauma and all of the fear and all of the anxiety and even the anger that they felt because of what they've been told. And this day you will set them up so that they might in turn raise up their heads, look up, for their redemption is drawing nigh. And I want to do that. I want to just, if I could just reach out through the television right now and just take your downcast head and lift it up and tell you, you can be proud because God Himself is calling you. And all you need to do is to turn to Him and to say, dear God, please forgive me for thinking that I was junk when you made me to be a person of significance this day. And I pray in the name of Jesus that somehow by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will come to faith in Jesus Christ and that you will experience His anointing in the Holy Spirit, and God will use you in a mighty and powerful way. And if we've been talking to you, or if that situation is similar to yours, please know that we're standing by to pray with you, to encourage you. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. God does not make junk. You're of eternal worth to Him, and He has a plan for your life. So give us a call. We'll be back with more right after this. Give us a call. Welcome back. Well, during these past several weeks, we've been praying across Canada, coast to coast, and President George Woodward is with us today, president of the Canadian 700 Club, and we are praying for what two provinces today?
Manitoba and Saskatchewan.
Great provinces and great people.
They are. You know, they've said about Manitoba with Winnipeg, of course, there's this corner that's Portage in Maine, and they said, well, that's the coldest place in Canada. Now, it's not, of course.
I thought Timmins was.
No, it's not. But what a wonderful city. We have both in Manitoba and Saskatchewan. You know, obviously, if we think about Saskatchewan, it's well worth Regina. That's the headquarters for the RCMP. So many things go on in Saskatchewan and Manitoba. Winnipeg is such a great city as well. And, you know, it's a real pleasure to be able to pray for those two areas today because God wants to do spectacular things in those provinces.
Well, George, let's pray. And would you lead us in prayer? And we'll agree. And you pray with us as we pray for these two great provinces here in Canada.
Let's pray. And you join with us as well today. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you, Father, that you love us, you love Canada, you have purpose and destiny for this land. I thank you for these two provinces. I thank you for Manitoba, Lord, and what you're doing there and how you're transforming that particular province and especially the downtown core areas of Winnipeg. Father, I thank you, Lord, for transformation there. Father, we think of Saskatchewan and, Lord, the tremendous heritage that it has. Revival started in a little place in northern Saskatchewan many years ago. And, Father, I believe you want to do it again. Mm. So, Father, we pray for transformation, for the gospel to go forth in great measure in both of these provinces. Today we ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Great. And Amen. Keep praying. We just need to keep praying for our nation and making a difference in our country. Prayer will change lives and change things. Now, recently we had a wonderful partner banquet in Toronto with Gordon Robertson, and he was there to share the gospel. We saw many miracles, and we also had some of our partners ask us some questions that we're going to try and answer here on Canadian Edition. As a matter of fact, we have a question from Mike. Let's hear Mike's question.
What do we have to do to precipitate revival in the mainline churches in Canada?
Oh, great question, George. Revival in our mainline churches.
Wow.
What's your thought?
Well, you know, I guess we would have to look back to some degree. And I really believe that so many of these churches came from a foundation that really believed the Bible.
That's right.
That really believed that God was real and what he said was the truth, and that we could put our confidence in each and everything that he said that was true and real. And so I think really there needs to be a transformation, not of new things, but rather of looking, what is the foundation here? What does the Bible truly say? And if we will go and believe the Word of God, believe that what he said is true for today, I believe there is a whole segment of our population that are being faithful to what we would consider these mainline churches, but really are hungry for the revival and transformation and really going back to the basics of living right and doing right, exactly what the Bible says.
I think so often when conservative Bible-believing Christians are in these mainline denominations, and they hear things from the pulpit or the church as a whole begins to promote things that they don't think square with the Bible, many times the attitude is one of reaction rather than prayer.
Yeah.
And I've discovered that I think one of the most important things we can do is to enlist God's help through the Holy Spirit by praying. And so I want to encourage you, if you're in a mainline denomination and you're wanting to see that local church or that denomination come alive in Jesus Christ, before criticizing or complaining, start praying. And again, part of what we need to understand, and I know you understand this as well, George, is that this is infectious. When we get hold of the Holy Spirit and we really get a burden to pray for the needs that are there in our church and in our denomination, yeah, then God begins to move through us in powerful ways. And so we just want to encourage you this day to pray, to be praying for Canada, to be praying for these provinces that we've mentioned to you, but also to be praying for God's work in each of these churches that, as George has indicated, have such a rich heritage and rich repository of truth. We just need that truth to be known. Now, we also want to encourage you to go to our website. That's CanadianEdition.com. All kinds of resources there to help you pray, as well as teaching materials. Well, for George Woodard, President of Christian Broadcasting Associates, and myself, God bless you. We'll see you next time on Canadian Edition.
For more information, or if you'd like to help continue the ministry of Canadian Edition, please write to us with your gift today. Our address is CBA, Post Office Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S4T4. Become a 700 Club partner and write today.